Hi, welcome to Finding Stuff Out, the show where I search for your answers, no matter how shocking they are. And you might be wondering why I'm walking on this red carpet. Well, it's not like I was nominated for an award or anything, but if you wanted to nominate me, that would be totally awesome. Actually, the reason I'm walking around on this carpet is because I'm trying to answer a question about a mysterious form of energy. So if my calculations are correct and I've shuffled just enough... Ouch! That was more than I expected. Must have been the shoes. Anyway, let's start off with a question. Sorry, I forgot to turn the monitor on. That's better. It's from Lysaya.
Why does my hair stick to my chair?
The short answer is... it's caused by a powerful force of nature. And today, I'll find out what that powerful force is and how to use it to make the kids of today superheroes. So now I have to find out why your hair sticks to your chair. It's probably something sticky. I guess the mysterious force isn't peanut butter. This calls for an investigation and another question. This one's from Steven.
What do you need electricity? If cavemen didn't, then they survived.
Here's an animated clip I made that should shed some light on your question.
True, cavemen didn't have electricity, but they did have another form of energy, fire, which back then wasn't easy to make. They could use it to cook and dry their clothes, or even as a light to read by. And for millions of years, fire served as a cheap substitute for family entertainment.
Oh no, Grog's favorite show preempted by Weather Network.
Staying warm, cooking food, and entertaining ourselves are just some of the things that we use electricity for. Now here's a question.
Why do so many things run on electricity?
From the world of physics, please welcome my special guest, Mark Nantel!
Hi!
Hi!
Ah, the mysterious force!
So why do so many things run on electricity?
Well, I mean, for very different reasons. In the case of light, it's just cleaner and it's more efficient, mm-hmm. and it's safer. In the case of a drill, a hand drill, you can put it in a battery and go anywhere you want. In the case of the watch, well, you know, you don't want to have to wind your watch all the time, and
no,
sometimes you forget.
It's a pain.
It's a pain. Well, the electric one works pretty much all the time for a long time. So that's why a lot of things work on electricity, essentially. And you know, Harrison, this makes light, right?
Mm-hmm.
It makes a lot of light, and it's great, but it's not very efficient.
Yeah.
Now, this little guy is very efficient.
Oh.
It doesn't take hardly any electricity to light up.
Cool. Let me find a battery.
Don't worry about it. I have everything we need in this lemon.
Ah.
Yeah, I'll show you. We'll make a battery with lemon.
Okay.
The lemon juice can be what's called an electrolyte. An electrolyte is something that is used in batteries to carry electricity from one side of the battery to the other side of the battery. So you take a lemon. You make a little slit in it. In the slit, you put a penny. And then you put a nail on the other side. Well, what you have here is essentially a little mini battery. Now, if you want to be clever, you make several of these guys, and then you can connect them in a row.
Mm.
So yeah, you take one side to the penny, the other side of the alligator clip goes to the nail.
Okay.
And you continue like that for a while, and the more lemons you put,
yeah,
the more power you get. So let's try to make it like this with a 4-lemon battery. Let's see if it works. It works! Ta-da!
So now there's a better saying. When life hands you lemons, don't make lemonade. Make a battery. Now here's a question from Joshua.
How do we make electricity?
How do we make electricity?
Well, Joshua, I think we already answered your question. There's a huge pile of lemons somewhere, the size of a mountain, along with some pennies and nails. right?
Well, not exactly. There are other ways to make electricity. Typically, you send something through a propeller of some kind.
Mm-hmm.
As it goes through, it gives electricity, and the electricity, in this case, can power the little light bulb, right? It could be wind. Sometimes you can put water and have it go down through a bunch of turbines. This is a fancy word for propellers.
Okay.
And then the propellers are connected to a generator, and at the end comes out electricity. Sometimes when you don't have water and you don't have wind, you may want to generate your own by boiling water and making steam, like really high pressure. Yep. And then you pass that through your propeller. And so how do you make the steam? You can use nuclear power, or you can decide to burn fossil fuels like coal or petroleum or natural gas. But another way you can do power that doesn't involve steam or nuclear power or anything are some maybe more sustainable ways, using what the Earth already gives you. Something like geothermal. So the Earth is hotter inside the Earth.
Yeah.
So if you dig a hole in the Earth, it's hotter than at the top. So you can actually get some of the heat that's there in order to help you generate electricity. But also you can use the tides. So if you go at high tides, you make sure there's water somewhere. And when tide becomes lower, all the water comes back down to go to the sea. And that's when you make it go through propellers again and turbines.
So no matter how you make the turbine turn, it generates electricity.
And the other way you could do it is using solar panels. So the sun is always there. It's shining on the Earth anyway. It's wasting a lot of energy. Let's imagine this is the sun, right?
Okay.
All right, well, just imagine. And we light this up. Watch it. Yay! There's your car. So we generated electricity that powered the little car just from the solar panel that's on its back.
No turbine needed.
So until we're using things that don't create pollution, how do we cut down on it?
You could use less electricity. That's the best way.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have lights on in the house that you don't need to have on, turn it off. You could still leave the TV on if you're watching this show, though.
Yeah. Now here's a question from Kirsten.
How does electricity travel through wires?
Imagine that a wire is this tube. Just like those marbles slide from one end of the tube to the other, when you turn a switch, all of a sudden, the electricity goes to where it's needed. If you turn off the switch, it stops. Turn on the switch, it goes.
So what are the marbles supposed to be?
Well, they're kind of an analogy to electrons.
Okay.
Electrons are little bits, the smallest bits of electricity you can find.
Cool. That was very illuminating. Thanks for being on my show, Mark.
No problem, my pleasure.
Speaking of moving electricity down a wire,
it's time for
My Great Challenge!
So Shoshana and Olivia, take your positions and get ready to compete.
Woo!
In real life, we have to move electricity long distances from where we make it to where we use it. So today, My Great Challenge is about moving electricity from one place to another. So you have to get the power from the batteries all the way up to the caveman who's holding the light bulbs, and the first one of you to get it all the way up to the caveman will be the winner.
And here's the tricky part. You have to use these wires and other stuff. But none of it is long enough to run from our batteries to our caveman's light. So you have to figure out what you can connect to the wires to carry current all the way between these streetlights and our cavemen. Here's a hint. Some of our materials are called conductors, meaning that electrons can flow through them. Others are called insulators, meaning that electrons can't flow through them.
When I touch these wires together, a buzzer will go off, and that's your signal to start. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a worm on this one.
Olivia starts with the toy worm. It's made out of rubber, so the light won't go on. Rubber does not conduct electricity. It's an insulator. Shoshana tries out the steel wool. Will it work?
Yes, I got one.
Yes! Metal is a great conductor of electricity. Electrons easily move through it. And now Olivia is doing the same. Shoshana is trying out the light stick. Uh-oh. It may light up inside, but the outside is plastic. Another insulator. Olivia doesn't seem to be using anything plastic anymore. That metal wire works.
Stay.
Yep, that knitting needle is also metal.
Shoshana's catching up. They're tied now.
They're both down to their last light, and Olivia's putting the pedal to the metal with aluminum foil.
Oh, the caveman's torch is lit up. We have a winner.
Olivia, congratulations.
Congratulations.
Street smarts.
So what would you do if there was no electricity?
Well, I would probably scream and run and cry.
I'll use like a lemon and dime and penny to light the little light.
I'd play the drums.
Yeah, I like this guy.
I just practiced my dancing.
To be honest with you, I don't really care if there's electricity or not.
I would just use a candle and just live my life.
I do like Benjamin Franklin or Thomas Edison did, learn on how to do it, or I just use my dog to tug me to school on my scooter.
I'll scream and die.
No electricity, my show wouldn't exist. That means you guys wouldn't be able to see me.
How come electric eels don't electrocute themselves?
Yeah, that's weird. How come electric eels don't electrocute themselves? Now that is mysterious. I've never thought of that before. An animal that makes electricity shocks other things but doesn't shock itself with electricity that it makes inside of its own body? That's shocking!
You're gonna make my head explode! To find out more about electric eels,
whoa!
I met up with Nicole Can at the aquarium.
An eel? That's not creepy enough. It has to be an electric eel. So, how do these things work anyway? Do you have to plug them in?
No, not at all. These electric eels can be found in the muddy waters of South America, and they generate electricity to stun their prey and to scare their predators, the things that want to eat them.
Okay, let me get out of here. Ugh, why would you want to eat an electric eel anyway? And how do they make electricity?
Well, on the back of their tail here, they actually have very specialized cells called electrocytes. And when they all fire at once, that's what creates the electric charge.
Okay, so to answer Jamie's question, how come they don't electrocute themselves?
The truth is, nobody knows. There's a couple of theories out there. Some people think that maybe they're immune to electricity, or maybe they just have all of their vital organs insulated from that charge.
Are they the only animals that make electricity? No, don't tell me sharks make electricity too. They're already dangerous enough with their teeth.
Okay, well, they don't actually make electricity, but they can detect it. They have special cells underneath their snouts, and all those cells do is they detect bioelectricity. So that's the electricity that any living thing makes, whether it's a fish or a person.
Wait, did you just say a person?
Yep.
Dun, dun, dun. Now my head really is going to explode. If my head's going to explode, maybe I should go see Dr. Joe Macker. He's a neuroscientist.
This is just one of Dr. Macker's friends.
So I heard that sharks can detect electrical activity in humans, and I was wondering if it's really true that we can make electricity inside of our own bodies.
Yes, that's absolutely true. And in fact, our brains can use as much electricity as a 60-watt light bulb. In fact, I can even show you that electrical activity in action in your brain right now. This is Harrison, our brain, and he's ready to be measured up.
Hi.
So Chantal's measuring your head and marking the spots where the wires that we're going to attach to your head are going to go. They need to be on exactly the right spots above the right part of your brain.
People always want to pick my brain, but this is ridiculous. Are these gonna suck my brain out?
No, but they will let us see the electrical activity of your brain.
Okay. My mom always thinks I'm wired. Now I'm actually wired.
That doesn't hurt, does it, Harrison?
No, it's just really cold, though.
Oh, it helps you keep a cool head.
This is what a bowl of spaghetti must feel like. Okay.
Great, so now Chantal is going to start the electroencephalogram, or EEG.
So I'm ready.
I'm going to ask you to close your eyes now.
The first test is to check out what happens if I keep my eyes closed, and then open them.
For the next part, I'm going to place this light, which will flash at you, and you'll need to close your eyes for this. Okay, we're done.
That was really weird. It was like the lights. And I like kind of wanted to open my eyes while they were like going, but I knew I wasn't supposed to, so I didn't. And it was just really weird.
It's time to see if I'm really full of energy. Yes! Check out my brain waves. That's electricity.
So here, this is when you had your eyes closed and everything is nice and calm. And if I just move forward a little bit.
Wow.
Yep, right there where the yellow blob is, that's when you open your eyes and suddenly there's a lot more going on.
Yeah, I really lit up today.
You certainly did. Okay, and here we're showing you the results of the flashing light that you had. Each of these pink spikes represents the flashing light coming on and off. And as you can see, as soon as we start flashing that light at you, the activity in your brain changes completely.
Yeah, it was really big and wavy there, and then as soon as the light came on, it was really small.
Right, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So it's true, my brain does generate electricity. But what do you use this for?
Well, we can use this to help people with epilepsy. In epilepsy, certain parts of the brain are firing when they shouldn't be. And so we can see that with this machine. And now we can even implant a device called a pacemaker into their brain, which regulates the activity so it's back to the way it should be firing.
Wow, so electricity can actually correct people's problems.
When you know what you're doing with it, yes.
Well then, maybe you can answer this question from one of our viewers.
Why don't grown-ups let kids touch electricity?
That's a very good question. In part, it's because the amount of electricity flowing within our brains is thousands of times less than what's in the wall. And also, when it's flowing from one part of our body to another, that's safe. It's dangerous when electricity comes out from outside our body and goes through us.
Yeah, that's an electric shock.
Exactly.
So remember, kids, don't play around with electricity that comes out of wall sockets, or you'll get socked with shocks.
The Flat Earth Corner!
In the 16th century, we've made huge medical advances. That's why we know that if you're suffering from certain ailments, like gout, there's a simple cure. Just stick your feet in a tub of electric eels.
Whoa! What a wonderful treatment! The electric shocks hurt so much I can't even think about my gout!
A few hundred years ago, doctors used to think if you suffered from headaches or an illness called gout, like Henry VIII, King of England, that you could be cured by sticking your foot into a tub of electric eels. Nowadays, we know that electric eels can't cure anything, except maybe boredom. I guess that's why Dr. Macker didn't have any in his lab. But speaking of Dr. Macker and his lab, it's time for...
Uh-oh. Do try this at home.
So, as I found out from Dr. Macker, your heartbeat and many other things inside of your body have electrical impulses. So to feel how that happens, place your fingers on your wrist like so. Can you feel that pulse? That's your heart pumping blood all around your body, which is controlled by tiny electrical signals. And more signals to help you keep your balance, all because of electrical impulses.
You've got electricity flowing through your whole body from cell to cell at awesome speed. You've got electricity when you're looking with your eyes, when you're smelling with your nose, when you're figuring some math, when you're wiggling your toes, when you're doing funky moves, or when you start to sneeze. You've got electricity. Yeah, you've got electricity flowing through your whole body from cell to cell at awesome speed. You've got electricity.
What's lightning?
What an electrifying question. I checked, and it's a lot like rubbing a balloon against the wall, except with way more electricity.
During a storm, water droplets and clouds rub together, causing friction. This friction causes electrons, which have a negative charge, to build up inside the clouds. The Earth is positively charged. In this case, opposites attract. Eventually, the attraction is too strong. And zap! There's your lightning. It's what's called static electricity. It's exactly what happens when I rub my feet on a carpet. The friction causes the negatively charged electrons to build up in my body. The electrons have nowhere to go until I put my finger close to the positively charged chair. Then bam! I get a shock, which is like a mini bolt of lightning. Which leads me back to the original question from Lasaya.
Why does my hair stick to my chair?
Big answer, Lasaya, is... electrons! It's like a tiny version of lightning. When your hair rubs against your chair, it's picking up electrons from it.
It's the same when I'm rubbing this balloon against my sweater. This creates negative and positive charges to build up. And that force causes my balloon to stick to my sweater.
Cool, my own electric eel balloon animal. I think he likes me. Let's get this party started.
How about some pointy teeth?
I guess that's goodbye to Mr. Eel. Thanks for watching Finding Stuff Out. See you next time.
So sad.
Let the force be with you.
Welcome to Finding Stuff Out. I'm on a trampoline with a popsicle and earmuffs because of some questions I got. Starting with this one. Sorry, it's just a bit tricky to get my remote without dropping my... popsicle.
Is there anything left to discover or invent?
I don't know, but by the end of the show, I'll find out. Meanwhile, I wish there was an invention that could keep me from dropping my popsicle while I click my remote, because I have another question. Not again.
You know, I'd like to invent something one day. Do kids invent things?
Yes, kids do invent things. And that's why I'm jumping on a trampoline with earmuffs and popsicles. Because all three of those things were invented by kids.
I found out that 15-year-old Chester Greenwood invented earmuffs in 1870 because his ears got cold when he went skating. Frank Epperson was only 11 when he invented popsicles. George Nissen was a teenager when he invented the trampoline, which he later taught a kangaroo to jump on with him. Jumping with a kangaroo wasn't an invention or a discovery, but it was pretty cool.
And kids invented other amazing things, too.
Like glow-in-the-dark paper, braille that allows blind people to read, an invention that would later become a TV, or a flashlight that turns body heat into light. No batteries required.
Okay. Maybe I can invent a hands-free way to hold my popsicle on the trampoline. Maybe not. But kids do invent stuff all the time, and we're going to meet some of them right now and see what their inventions are.
This is a huge science fair. 500 kids who love science are here to show off their ideas, experiments, and inventions. And I'm gonna meet some of them right now.
Hi, Dylan. So what's your invention?
My project's about generating power from the sun without using solar panels. The way I'm doing this is using mirrors. So the sun is hitting these mirrors, reflecting back, and creating a superheated spot.
That's hot.
My dish needs to be facing the sun at all times. So I developed my own active tracking software.
Cool, but this needs to be bigger, right?
Yes, my plan is to make a very large version. I have a 3-meter dish and a 14-foot arch on top of my roof, and hopefully heat my hot water tank, my house, and power my lights.
Wow, free energy.
Exactly, free energy. This is my passion, and it feels amazing.
It is amazing. Good luck. Our next inventor made something that doesn't use the sun, but it definitely is out of this world. Hi.
Hi, Zoe. My name is Eunyoung Kim, and I invented a glove that's for astronauts to use on Mars.
Whoa.
Since Mars is so dusty, my glove helps astronauts pick up their tools because basically they're blind on Mars. So there's sensors built into this glove, and when the sensors get close to an object, it sends signals to this small computer that makes the glove vibrate.
Do you think NASA will want to use your invention?
Yes, I think it's a good opportunity for NASA to use this glove when they go to Mars.
Woohoo! Let's hope they do. Now here's an invention that you definitely don't need gloves to use. Hi.
Gwei, my name is Dehodanyoskai. I'm from a First Nations community called Gahnawage, and my project is the door pedal. The door pedal allows you to open up your door using your foot instead of your hands.
Cool, but who uses it?
I went to my local hospital and I allowed a nurse to try it out because there's lots of germs in the hospital. She said it was very sanitary because she doesn't have to touch the door handle anymore. And also at my grandmother's convenience store. So now when she's bringing big, heavy things into her store, she can now just open it with her foot.
This should open doors for me.
Talk about using your head and your feet. And here's Tamid. He invented a wheel that can adjust to any road condition.
You can see that the wheel is a complete circle right now. You can see it changes into something very, very spiky. I've spent many weeks, months on the computer screen trying to get my parts to fit together, and when it finally did, when the wheel was finally able to turn and also change shape, it felt great. This really works well in sand, in snow, in mud, but then when you come back to a highway, you're able to press the button again and get it back to a circle.
Well, that's like reinventing the wheel. Thanks. Now here are two people who also took a really old invention and made it into something new and amazing. Hi! Jenna and Elijah are Inuit and live in the far north in Saluit, Nunavut.
That's Inuit oil lamp.
They worked out a way to use the heat of a traditional oil lamp and make electricity to charge a cell phone.
Heat from Hulik, it make electricity so you can charge when you're camping.
So you never run out of power. Cool. That's a lot of inventions. But what about discoveries? Here's a question from Michael.
What is the difference between a discovery and an invention?
Yeah. What's the difference? That's what I asked some of my friends.
Ask a friend.
An invention is something that you make,
and a discovery is when you find something, but it's already made by nature.
A discovery is when you find something new, and an invention is when you make something new.
Well, I checked, and I found out you guys are right. Now,
speaking of discoveries, here's a question from Daniel.
What does Eureka mean?
Well, Daniel, when I was trying to find out what Eureka means, I found this great story. So I made this animation. Archimedes was an ancient Greek mathematician, philosopher, engineer, astronomer, and inventor. Fortunately, despite being very busy, rumor has it he still took a bath regularly. The story is he discovered the principle of displacement when he noticed how the water level rose when he lowered his body into it. When he realized his discovery, he shouted out,
Eureka!
Which is the ancient Greek word for I have found it. Archimedes also discovered that stuff that's less dense than water, like gases for instance, float to the surface instead of sinking to the bottom. We don't know how he discovered that, but you never know.
Eureka!
Speaking of Eureka, I had an idea to put bouncy springs on my popsicle, so while I'm on the trampoline, it can bounce along with me. Oh, no. If I can't invent a way, maybe I'll discover one eventually. I have discovered that kids have discovered a lot of cool things. When she was 10, Catherine Gray discovered a supernova. That's an exploding star. And Catherine is a bit of a star herself because she's the youngest person to ever discover a supernova. 15-year-old Tom Wagg discovered his own planet. And 15-year-old Willem Gattery may have discovered a lost Mayan city by using star maps. And lots of kids have discovered ancient fossils.
Hey, cool! A dinosaur fossil. Here's a question from Mateus.
Who found the first fossils of a dinosaur?
Flat Earth Corner! Oh, I wish I could find something really valuable down here, like gold. Hey, that's odd. There's something there.
Forsooth, I found the bones of a dragon.
Hey, I wonder if these bones would taste good in soup. I could be the first kid to invent dragon soup.
People who found the first dinosaur fossils thought they were the bones of dragons.
Yes, dinosaurs do sort of look like dragons, but it took a while for people to realize what they'd found. And it took a while for the grand prize winner of the science fair to discover a treatment that might help some people feel better.
Hi, Zoe. My name is Melissa, and I was able to make a discovery in many patients that had a type of cancer, lymphoma. So it's a cancer of the blood cells. They're usually treated with something called chemotherapy. Then the cancer patient usually starts to feel really bad because that treatment kills your good and bad cells all at the same time. I wanted to develop a new method to help cancer patients so that they wouldn't become so weak.
Wow. What inspired you to do that?
I have an uncle who has cancer. I also have many friends who are related to other people who also have cancer. So it affects many people, and I wanted to do something that would help a lot of people. I still have a lot more research to do, and hopefully one day be able to really make this treatment available for everybody.
Good luck. Thanks, Melissa.
Now I'm going to meet some inventors who also had a very personal reason for making their inventions.
This is Samantha Gway and Tegan Kitt. They also wanted to invent something that would help people. Wow, this isn't like any other boot I've ever seen before.
We were inspired to invent it by one of our friends who is almost always getting hurt. She has a lot of accidents.
She fell off a trampoline once.
She fell off her bike.
And a fence.
So I'm guessing this boot doesn't prevent injuries. What does it do?
Our friend was always getting cast, and when she was going out in the rain, it would always get wet, so we wanted to make a boot so she didn't have to get her cast wet.
And the whole cast can fit inside, and it just does up.
To try it out, I put on some extra heavy socks so it'd be like I have a cast.
Now you can put the boot on and see how it works.
Cool, no laces.
How does it feel?
It's comfy. I could see how this could hold a cast. Ta-da!
In the beginning, our invention was going to be on a shoe, but the shape wasn't right, so we picked a boot.
And when we were making the boot, some of the glue wasn't strong enough, so we had to get new glue.
First, when we were doing it, we used magnets like this on one side and washers on the other side, but it wasn't strong enough, so
we decided to use
magnets on both sides.
Okay, now I'm going to put your boot to the test. So my foot won't get soaked?
Not a chance.
Definitely not.
Okay, I'm gonna go a little bit more daring. Hey, my foot isn't wet.
That's awesome.
It's actually meant for puddles, but it works in the shallow end.
What's next for you inventors?
We would like to add some reflectors to the boot to make it more safe at night.
And add some cool designs to make it more fashionable. And we also have come up with a logo.
Puddle jumpers. Awesome. So Samantha and Tegan were inspired by trying to keep things dry. Now here's an invention created by someone who wanted to make sure people could get wet when they need to.
Rachel Brower won medals at two science fairs, including a gold medal for her very watery invention.
Hi, Rachel.
Hi, Zoe.
So what did you invent?
So this is a water pasteurization system for third world countries. It removes the bacteria and impurities from water, making it safe to drink.
What inspired you to make this?
So a couple years ago, when I was 11, my family went hiking in New Hampshire. We saw the lakes and the rivers, but then we saw the contaminated do not drink signs. And at the same time, I was reading the I'm Malala book. And in this book, many women and girls are dying from the cholera outbreak. So I put the two things together and I decided I wanted to make a difference.
Cool, so how does it work?
So first the water is pumped from a water hole or lake, and then it runs through this basic cotton and charcoal filter system. Once it runs through the system, the 2-liter bottles are filled up, and then you would remove them from the system.
What did you find difficult?
So though the system removes the impurities, I found that bacteria is also found in water, That's when I designed this novel color-changing wax indicator. So once your 2-liter bottles are removed from the system, you'd place this inside and then place your bottles on a piece of corrugated tin roof. The sun will heat the water to 40 degrees Celsius, and this blue wax will change from dark blue to light pink, indicating that the water's heating up. Then once that water reaches 60 degrees Celsius, this will melt and run into the second vial, indicating that the water is safe to drink.
Wow, that's awesome. So what's next?
And this summer, my system will be tested in Kenya and Pakistan.
Do you have a message for kids who'd like to invent stuff?
Find something you're passionate about, and just because you're a kid doesn't mean that you can't make a difference.
Thanks for being on my show and showing us your invention. Now here's a question from Yasmina.
How many discoveries and inventions are there in this world?
How many inventions and discoveries are there? Let's see. Electricity, fire, air conditioning, toilet paper, the printing press, vaccines, head getting warm, refrigeration to keep heads from getting warm, eyeglasses, internet, jet engines, airplanes, helicopters, rockets, compasses, calendars, cars, radios, cranium getting hot, brain starting to overload, factorization, telephones, boat, motors, cars, radio, cranium getting hot, DVD, drone, booting, synapses firing like a laser, oh no!
Ah! Yay.
You're gonna make my head explode! The truth is, nobody really knows how many inventions and discoveries there are, because there have been so many throughout history. And this gives me an idea for a song. Inventions and discoveries, doing something new. They help us do things that we wanna do, like dreaming up a robot to help us clean our room, create a kind of rocket to take us to the moon. From the sun, non-polluting cars, gloves that help you find your tools on Mars. Inventing and discovery, it's doing something new. Inventing and discovering will open doors for you. Inventing and discovering will open doors for you. Inventing and discovering will open doors for you. My great challenge!
Today's challengers are Angelie and Logan.
Yay!
Versus Stefano and Sasha.
Yeah!
I'm gonna show you some weird inventions, and both teams have to guess what they are.
If neither team gets the answer, you get a clue.
The team that gets the most correct answers wins. You ready?
Yeah.
Okay, you girls are gonna go first. Okay.
I think it's like for the baby to go inside. And
babies are bigger than this.
So, like the new...
We're going for hammock.
I guess.
Okay.
A hammock?
Yeah.
Sorry, girls, that's wrong. Boys, your turn.
Don't see it. Oh, nice cat.
A bag of litter for cats.
Sorry, guys, that's not it. Okay, you guys get the clue now.
It's a bed.
Yeah.
You guys were right. It's a bed for cats.
Yes.
What is it?
Cheese shredder or
something shredder.
Yeah, it looks like a shredder. Yeah, it comes out from here.
Yeah.
Is it like a shredder?
Sorry guys, you're wrong.
So I think it's something that you could put like a fruit or something inside.
A fruit cutter, let's say.
A cutter? Mm-hmm. Sorry guys, that's wrong as well. So you guys now get the clue.
A juicer.
Yeah, you guys are right.
Yeah.
You put the lemon in and you squish it, comes out. You hear that?
Yeah, I hear it.
Let's see how much juice it made.
Oh, you spilled some.
What is it?
It has to be like a decoration for something.
I don't think so.
It's something that we...
used to clean a toilet or something? A drain?
Sorry, girls, that's wrong. Okay, you guys go.
But could it be a decoration? Because this could be the hair. This is a little like... No, why would it be a doll? But can't you see? Does this look like a doll's hair?
Ooh.
Okay, guys, I need an answer.
A decoration.
Decoration?
Sorry, guys, that's also wrong. Okay, now you guys get the clue.
Oh, it's a potato smasher?
You guys are right. When it's baked, you mash it.
Oh, I know what it is. It's like one of these old-fashioned bells. Hold on.
Yeah, I think it's a bell.
Yes,
there's no, like, ball inside.
And you put the ball inside.
I need a final answer.
What did I say?
A bell?
Sorry, guys. That's wrong.
Sorry, turn.
Is it to take out a core of an apple?
Nope. You guys get the clue.
Maybe a lighter?
No, impossible, because there's no fire thingamajig.
Yeah, but you could put something in.
A lighter for candles?
Sorry, girls, it's not it.
Maybe not.
Is it to take out the light? Yeah, you guys are right.
Yes!
You use this to put out a candle without burning your fingers.
All right.
Okay, both teams have 2 points. So this is the tiebreaker. What is it?
A measuring magnet?
A measuring magnet? Sorry, girls, that isn't it.
There's circles on it.
Could it be a tracer?
Is it a tracer?
Sorry, guys, that's not a tracer. So you guys now get the clue.
Oh, my.
It's the whole...
It's a tool.
Is it to measure the pasta?
You guys are right, it wins!
Yes! Yes.
What you do is you put it in, and that's how you measure it for 3 people.
That's cool, I need that at home.
Well, thanks for being on my show and helping me find stuff out. Now, time to answer the question that inspired my show today.
Is there anything left to discover or invent? The big answer is...
Well, Anthony, to answer your question, I've decided to ask someone who's gone all the way to space to discover things. Astronaut Chris Hadfield. Chris, thanks for being on my show. So, do you have an answer to Anthony's question? Is there anything left to invent or discover?
Zoe, we have no idea what we're doing. We are just getting started. We don't know what 94% of the universe is even made of. We are just infants. There are so many problems that we need to solve, and we're counting on scientists and engineers and bright young people like you and like people right across the country and around the world to solve those problems. So there's a whole world of things to discover and learn from and improve the quality of life with.
Thanks, Chris. Well, that's my show for today. By the way, notice anything different? I finally invented a popsicle holder that lets me use my remote and take my earmuffs off. See you next time for more finding stuff out. I can run super duper fast. I want to be the fastest kid in my class. Maybe even the whole school. But I'm still not fast enough. That reminds me of a question I got from Faith.
How do you make things go faster?
That sounds easy, but some things just don't move very fast. Like, if I throw a piece of paper with all my might, it still won't move very fast. I don't know the answer yet, but I promise to find out by the end of the show how to make things move faster. But first, here's a real quick question from Ella.
What's the fastest thing in the world?
Good question.
The fastest land animal is a cheetah.
It can reach speeds of 120 kilometers per hour.
That's faster than the speed limit on a highway.
The fastest vehicle on land is a rocket sled at 10,325 kilometers per hour.
That's 31 football fields per second.
It's used by the U.S. Air Force to test equipment.
What?
The Juno spacecraft can go 265,000 kilometers per hour as it whizzes through space!
265,000 kilometers per hour? It's like going around the world in 10 minutes! Or going to the moon in an hour and a half! It's 80 times faster than a bullet!
Yay. You're gonna make my head explode!
But how do things get to move so fast?
To speed things up, please welcome Canadian Space Agency engineer, Kumi Jinadasa.
Hi, Zoe.
Whoa, that was fast.
I love going fast. Follow me.
It looks like you love going fast as much as I do.
Actually, I really do. When I was a kid, I was really interested in how fast things move and why they move so fast. With my job at the Canadian Space Agency, knowing how motion works really comes into play in every single piece of equipment that we deal with. Whether it be an astronaut doing a spacewalk, blasting a rocket off into outer space, or how a rover moves on different planets.
What's the difference between going fast on Earth than in space?
To move fast in space, it's actually a little bit easier because on Earth we have 2 different forces. The first is gravity.
Oh yeah, when I jump up, I fall down.
Exactly. The second force is friction. What would happen if you stuck your hand out of a car window that's moving?
it's like going back and forth.
It's pushing you because there's a resistance, and that is air friction.
Oh, kind of like when I throw this piece of paper, the air slows it down.
The air does slow it down, and it falls to the ground because of gravity. But in space, that piece of paper would continue moving for a very, very long time because there's no air.
What if I wanted to make things move faster here on Earth?
Well, Zoe, follow me. Hey, what took you so long? I have something to show you. This is actually a picture of me when I was in grade 10 at my science fair. And I have a device here that I made that demonstrates the effects of friction. Here on the table, we have a really similar device. Basically, we have a box, and there's two hair dryers with holes in the box so the air can go into the box. And then I have this piece of hard plastic, and the air comes out of these holes. I want you to observe how this cup moves on the smooth surface.
Okay.
It stops.
Yeah.
Let's observe what happens to the cup if we turn the air on.
Okay.
So what did you observe?
It was like the cup was floating.
That's right. The air made a thin layer on the surface, and the cup wasn't in contact with it. So there was no friction. In my science fair project, I also wanted to observe different levels of friction with different materials. Okay, let's take this styrofoam mat. How do you think the motion's gonna be?
I feel like there's gonna be a lot of friction.
Let's see. It barely moves.
Yeah.
This has a lot more friction than the smooth surface. Let's try with the wood.
Better, but still stops.
Yeah, let's try with Bristol board. Still has a lot of friction.
Yeah.
If we have no friction, this cup can move faster and a lot easier. And that leads us into the first law of motion.
An object at rest stays at rest. And an object in motion stays in motion. Unless acted upon by a force.
We can demonstrate the second law of motion playing a game of air hockey.
I'm in.
Let's do it.
I scored!
Nice! What do you think would happen if this puck was heavier?
It probably wouldn't move as fast.
Want to try?
Yeah.
Let's use this as a weight on top of the puck. And I'm going to use this ruler so that I could push both pucks at the same time with the same force.
Okay.
I scored!
Yeah! The lighter one went way farther.
That's right. What do you think we need to do to this one to make it move just as far?
You need to push it harder.
That's right, Zoe. We need more force.
Law of motion number two. To move something faster, you need to push harder.
To demonstrate the third law, we have these two identical rolling chairs.
Push!
What did you notice about the motion?
Well, we both went back, but I went further because I'm lighter.
That's right. What would happen if we were the same weight?
We would both go back the same distance.
That's exactly how the law is stated. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. A good tip to make things move faster is to keep these laws in mind.
Thanks for helping me find stuff out, Kumi.
You're welcome.
Bye.
Bye.
The experiment!
Hi, Fabiola, Aaron, and Shaquib.
Hi, Zoe. Hi, Zoe.
What's your speedy experiment today?
Today's experiment, we're going to use some playing cards, some empty water bottles, and some objects we found around the house. Fabiola has some loose change that she found, Aaron has some hex nuts, and I have a battery. What we're going to do is apply a force to our playing cards and then see what happens to our everyday objects.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hooray!
How did that happen?
Now, our playing cards are much lighter than our everyday objects, so when we applied a force to the playing cards, they went flying away. But our battery is much heavier. When our playing card moved out of the way, there was an empty hole in the top of the water bottle, and gravity did the rest for us.
So, the heavier the object, the easier it is?
That's right.
My trick was harder than yours because my hex nut is lighter than your battery.
And my trick was harder than both of yours because my dimes are lighter than your hex nut and your battery.
Absolutely correct. But I do have another experiment to share with you, Zoe.
Awesome. Now we're gonna do the tablecloth trick.
What I'm going to do is take some water and pour it into my cups here. One, two, and three. Next, what we're going to do is build a little bit of a tower. So I've got a bowl, a cup, a plate, a bowl, a cup, and then again, a plate, a bowl, and a cup. What I'm going to do is pull on the tablecloth, and hopefully the whole tower will stay standing and the tablecloth will get pulled from underneath. Are you ready, Zoe?
Yes.
Here we go. 3, 2, 1. Ta-da!
Wow.
What about you, Aaron?
Awesome. Fabiola, you try.
Oh no, you weren't fast enough.
Speed makes all the difference. Thanks, guys.
Bye, Zoe. Bye.
That makes me think of something my friend was wondering.
What's the fastest object in sports?
Is it a hockey puck, a soccer ball, a tennis ball, a baseball? It's none of these. I found out it's a badminton birdie.
Hey.
The record is 493 kilometers an hour. Whee! That's almost 4 times faster than the fastest fastball in baseball. Badminton birdies may be the fastest sports object, but badminton isn't actually the fastest sport.
I want to see fast, and they're gonna show me table tennis experts Wenbin and Tommy.
Hi, Wenbin.
Hello.
Hi, Tommy.
Hi.
You guys move crazy fast.
Thanks, Zoe. Although badminton birdies can gather the most speed, table tennis is actually the sport where the athletes require the fastest reaction times.
Reaction time is the time between when a person notices something and reacts. Or not.
Because of the ball speed versus the table length, table tennis players need to react really fast. And sometimes when the ball comes too fast, you actually have to react before your opponent hits the ball in order to react to your opponent's ball.
What? Before he hits the ball?
In order to do that, you need to look at your opponent's positioning, his body language, how his shoulders are placed, and how he prepares for the ball.
Wow, you hit that ball really hard, and it still hit the table. How did you do that?
In order to hit the ball really hard and still make it land on the table, you need to put spin on the ball. In this case, you need to put top spin. When the ball goes in that direction, there is air resistance countering the ball in the opposite direction. When the ball spins like this, there's something called the Magnus effect. When the top of the ball hits that air resistance, that creates pressure on top of the ball and less pressure on the bottom. That makes the ball drop. So you can hit hard and still make the ball drop.
Oh yeah, the ball is dropping way sooner because of how you hit it.
We can also put side spin. So the ball can spin in this direction, in the other direction, or even underspin, which makes the ball spin in this direction.
Cool, can you show me?
Did you see how that ball turned?
Wow, they're really fast. I wonder how fast my friends' reaction times are. It's time for...
My Great Challenge!
Today's challengers are Maxim and Kenny.
The challenge for you is to see who can hit the most balls against Tommy.
Maxim, you'll go first. Ready? And go!
Challengers get 2 rounds. Maxime is volleying like a pro. 15 balls. He's off to a good start.
Kenny, you're up. And go!
Wow, Kenny's going really fast. He'll beat Maxime's score if he keeps us up. Oh. Oh no, 14 balls. One more would have tied it up.
Okay, Maxime, you're up again. And go!
Maxime is ahead by 1. Can he hold on to his lead? Both challengers are giving Tommy a run for his money. 13, 14, 15. He's doing better in round 2. Oh no. 18, and he's done.
Okay, Kenny. And go.
Kenny needs to keep that ball alive if he wants to catch up. 18, 19. Wow. Kenny takes the lead. How many more can he hit? He's like a table tennis machine. 38 balls in round 2. Awesome.
The results are in.
33 for Maxim and 53 for Kenny.
Kenny, you're the winner!
Good job! Yay.
Uh-oh, Duke tried this at home.
How about checking out your own reaction time? My friends have a simple way to do that.
Hi, Kenya and William.
Hi, Zoe.
Show us your trick. It's called the ruler drop. When you catch it, look at the number on the ruler.
10.
The lower the number, the faster your reaction time.
17. 8. 29.
And who's got the fastest reaction time?
Me.
Thanks, guys.
Bye, Zoe.
Next question. It's from Laura.
Is it possible to fall out of the roller coaster if it's too fast?
Great question, Laura. I asked my friend Shaquille to answer that. Take it away.
I love roller coasters and loop-de-loops, but how do those cars stick to the rails? We're going to use a large yellow bucket, thank you, Zoe, and then a pail of ping pong balls. As I spin it around, I'm changing the acceleration and creating something called centripetal force. That centripetal force sticks my ping pong balls to my big yellow bucket. Would you like to give it a try, Zoe?
Sure.
Go ahead. Wow, that's great. Now, as Zoe spins that bucket faster and faster, there's more force created and the balls don't rattle around anymore. But if Zoe slows down any, oh no! We made a big mess.
So, going faster on a roller coaster keeps you safer?
Absolutely. The faster you go, the safer you are.
I really do love super fast roller coasters. Thanks, Shaquille.
You're welcome.
I asked my friends why they like it.
Ask a friend.
It feels like you're going so fast that you can't feel yourself.
It's like I'm lifting off the seat.
It feels like I'm skydiving.
I like the wind in my face.
It like tickles your stomach.
I kind of feel like I'm free. It feels good.
The best thing ever. I love being scared and I get scared a lot.
The speed makes it fun.
That kind of speed would have scared people not so long ago. Taphophobia is a fear of speed and going fast. And let me tell you, I've got it bad. I'm zipping along on this new invention called a bicycle. Crazy! They say if I go too fast, I'll get bicycle face. Like this. Uh-oh! Now I'm on a train, moving even faster. Our bodies weren't made to travel at incredible speeds of 50 kilometers per hour. Our bodies will melt! Oh dear, now I'm in a car. This is crazy, I'm a girl. Girls can't drive this fast, we'll faint. What? Girls not allowed to go fast? That's nutty. People in the past had some strange ideas about speed and it scared them. But I love to go fast. And the human body can deal with very high speed.
On the ground, one driver zoomed at 1,223 kilometers per hour in the jet-propelled car Thrust SSC. In the air, pilots have flown 7,275 kilometers per hour. In space, astronauts have flown 40,000 kilometers an hour.
So people in the past had nothing to worry about. But all this speed talk makes me want to move faster and faster!
I love to run fast. I love to move quick. I love to zoom and zip. My moves are so slick when I hit the track. I don't look back because I love to run fast. Woohoo! Yippee! I love to make tracks. I love to vamoose. I am booking and I'm cooking and I'm jetting loose. When I hit the track, I don't look back because I love to run fast.
So fast. Wow, I can't believe I was racing with champion sprinters Tatiana Aholu and Deandra Green.
Tatiana and Deandra are amazing athletes. They competed in the Commonwealth Youth Games and brought home medals. They work super hard at going super fast.
What an honor it is to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Nice to meet you, Zoe.
My friend has a question.
How can a human run faster?
We ask ourselves that all the time. And I know someone who can help us with that. This is my coach, Rashid Din.
Hey, Zoe, I heard you really want to run faster.
I do.
I can help you. First thing to do is to time you so we can tell that you're improving. Ready to race?
I was born ready.
On your marks, set, go. Great job.
Thanks.
All right, so let's see if we can improve this. But most importantly, we're going to change your clothing.
Okay. Check me out. I look so fast.
Those form-fitting clothes will decrease wind resistance. That's the friction from the air that was slowing you down before.
Oh, I get it. My slick new clothes decrease friction, just like the plexiglass in Kumi's air table. What about my shoes? My friend Adriana was wondering.
Why do shoes make you run faster?
The right shoes can make you run faster, but not those. Try these. These shoes help you stick to the track, and it allows you to push off the track without slipping.
Wait a minute, that's friction. My slick clothes decrease friction and wind resistance, but my shoes actually increase friction with the ground, pushing me forward.
That is correct.
Okay, I'm all suited up. What's next?
First thing is your body posture. Stand up straight, hips in front, arms. 90 degrees bent, pull one arm back, while the other one comes right in front of you. What's important that this hand that's in front is to your mouth level. Remember, keep your arms close to your body. Stay tall at all times. And your knees. Very important to raise your knee high and pull your toes up. Then down. Push back and then forward. Push back. Good. Are you ready to race?
I sure am.
It's not always about winning, but it's really important in achieving your personal best with some stiff competition.
Another race with Tatiana and Deandra? This is the best race day ever.
Set, go.
Good job, Zoe.
Thanks.
Good job, Zoe.
Guys, really well done. Zoe, you ran 1.6 seconds faster. A new personal best.
Woohoo! Thanks. I've been fast and speedy and raced my way back to answer today's big question.
How do you make things go faster?
The big answer is... increase the force and adjust friction.
In Kumi's experiment, we saw that less friction made the cup move faster. On the racetrack, less friction for my clothes, but more friction for my shoes, helped me go faster. Also, increasing the force on something makes it go faster. And if you have a quick reaction time, you're on your way to a fast victory.
Oh yeah, new personal best. I'm out of here. See you next time for more fun.